Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Artwives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Artwives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access. Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. I'm Susan Merrick and today I'm talking with Dr. Rachel Epp Buller. Rachel is a feminist, art historian, visual artist, professor, mama of three, whose recent work, art and scholarship speak to the intersections of this perpetual balancing act. Hi, Rachel.
Hi, good to talk to you, Susan.
And you, so good of you to join us. So that's a nice, fun, mouthy introduction with lots of different roles.
Yes.
So my first question is, which of those roles came first?
I guess I would have to say probably the feminist came first. Maybe the artist. I remember doing lots of projects when I was very small. But really sort of the formative role that came first, I would say was a feminist background. My mother was, or is, a woman in science. She was a chemist and then a chemistry teacher and very much the minority in her graduate programs and later in her work and teaching career. And I think that was really, I always knew that about her. And I think it impacted the ways that she moved in the world and raised her children. Just made me aware of gender disparities in a different way from a pretty young age. Read Ms. Magazine in high school and identified as a feminist pretty early on. So that would be the first one, I think.
Awesome. That's must have been great to have. Well, actually, I wonder if you appreciate it when you're younger. I was definitely a feminist from a really young age as well, but my mum would have definitely, she would not have called herself a feminist, but some of her views and her actions definitely were. Mm-hmm. I don't think she would have even really acknowledged the term.
Yeah.
I think it's a powerful start to have that in your life, I think, from a young age.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, looking back, I don't think I necessarily recognized it at the time, but it certainly has informed the way I've raised my own kids, and wanting to be more open with talking with them about all kinds of things in our world, so that they're more aware and help them develop sort of a critical lens to what they see happening around them. I mean, not just about gender, but about all kinds of things.
Absolutely. So the mama of three part of that description seems to be a very large part. You talk about, being at the intersection of all these things and that mothering element or the maternal element being a big part of that. Do you think that it was like many of us, your own experience of mothering that brought you to working within that intersection, or were you already working in that way prior to having children yourself?
So I guess I would say yes and yes. I think the roles just sort of continued to layer on together. So as I was identifying as a feminist and an artist, and then went to graduate school in art history and studying feminist art history, adding kids to that just helped me see sort of a new layer to all of this because, in studying feminist art history, I really had considered very little about maternal bodies or even the presence of maternity. It seemed like such a huge blind spot for me looking back, but I think not just for me, for many art historians. I think it was definitely my own personal experience that helped me start looking at things in a different way. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I know you're also part of the Feminist Art mm-hmm. Project, right? Can you tell us a bit more about this project, please, and your involvement
yeah,
in it?
Yeah, so the Feminist Art Project, it's an international organization. It's housed at Rutgers University in New Jersey. It's been going for, I don't know, well over a decade. It's sort of an umbrella organization in a sense, as a way to gather, document, record, and promote different feminist art events, whether that's exhibitions or books or lectures or workshops, you know, that are happening in different places around the world, sort of trying to maintain connections between people, even though we're all very spread out in various ways. So my involvement is as a regional coordinator. So in the U.S., there are coordinators for all the different states, and that's, you know, it's just a volunteer position to agree to be the coordinator for your state, or sometimes there are multiple coordinators. Mm-hmm. And what it looks like in each state really varies. I live in Kansas, which is it's a geographically large area, but with a relatively low population. So we're all spread out from each other. So what my involvement tends to look like is organizing occasional exhibitions, trying to gather artists from different parts of the state to exhibit together or to think together about a particular topic for art making. Occasional events I try to promote. I have a website where we try to promote exhibitions or other events that are happening just to kind of get the word out. In a high population area, it could look very much like gathering people monthly for studio visits or for conversation or, you know, but in a state like mine, it's so spread out that, you know, it's not really feasible, to try to gather people in the same way. Although I guess in these days we could gather on Zoom and that would seem totally normal now.
So does it, is it kind of self-referring? Do people, do people refer by word of mouth? How do you get to?
So it's very much, sort of word of mouth, and people can, you know, whoever wants to can send in. If you're having an exhibition, you send in your information to the website people, and they put it on their website and help promote it, and they encourage people to use sort of the logo of the Feminist Art Project. You know, if that feels helpful to have your whatever your work is, you know, having it be part of this larger entity. To connect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
What an
for
amazing
sure.
archive mm-hmm. as well. Okay. Amazing. Right. So you are also mm-hmm. an author and editor of several books on art and the maternal, including most recently Inappropriate Bodies, but also some of the books are Mothering Mennonite, Have Milk, Will Travel, and Reconciling Art and Mothering, just to name a few. When I was researching what you've done, Rachel, Mothering Mennonite really struck out to me because I didn't know this term, Mennonite, so I looked it up. I may be just being really ignorant, but I looked it up and realized I suppose you'll be better to describe this to me, but the internet told me it describes kind of several religious groups mm-hmm. Across the world of, I suppose, kind of Baptist type philosophy, including quite closed communities that we may have heard of, especially around America and some parts of Central Europe. Could you tell me what led you to mm-hmm. looking at Mennonite mothering specifically, and how you came to be looking at that? Because I'm really interested in those kinds of closed communities and the roles of women and the. Mm-hmm. the way women view themselves within those types of communities anyway. So,
I guess it's sort of similar to the the earlier question about, you know, my own experiences and how that informed the directions I went, which is very much the case with the Mothering Mennonite book. So I was raised by parents who'd been raised in the Mennonite church. There are, as you found in your looking online, there are lots of different kinds of Mennonites around the world. It's, you know, it's a relatively small denomination, Protestant denomination, compared to, you know, like the Lutheran church or Methodists. There are many more of them. So it's relatively small, but there are...
I was born a Methodist.
Oh, okay. Okay. But there are, you know, several different kinds of Mennonites. And as you found, some are very closed, insular kinds of communities. In the U.S., we would think of them more like Amish, maybe, something more well-known. But there are also very sort of mainstream Protestant denominations who identify as Mennonite. And I think being raised as a Mennonite, you know, one of the, you know, there are a couple of hallmarks for that, you know, whether it's mainstream or insular. And that's, those are that they're Anabaptists, meaning believing in adult baptism. So rather than baptizing infants, wanting it to be a conversation and an intentional choice. And then the other big piece is being one of the historic peace churches, meaning that they don't support war and militarization. So a long history of conscientious objection, which I think, has really informed my, I guess, participation in the Mennonite church. So very service, or, you know, so there's the conscientious objection piece, but also being very service oriented, wanting to, rather than supporting war and militarization, wanting to invest in concrete ways that people can help each other around the world, whether that's, you know, and there's a group called Mennonite Disaster Service, that, you know, we're, you know, sends volunteers to places after there's been flooding or a hurricane, to help rebuild and clean up and all of that. And, so really wanting to put faith into action.
Okay.
So that's a kind of a long background to, Mennonites. But for me, wanting to think of, more intentionally about the mothering piece, because I think what's maybe common, between Mennonites, Methodists, Catholics, Jews, Muslims, is that in many cases, both the religious ideas and also the ways that those ideals are conveyed culturally are very often passed through the women, through the mothers, the grandmothers, to the children. And, as I was beginning to read a little bit more about Mennonite history and culture, you know, it was pretty stark that there was very little written about women. Marlene Epp in Canada is a historian who was really the first to start writing about Mennonite women. But there was very little about, not only women, but mothers specifically. And so wanting to offer a space for those discussions, you know, what that would look like, or what that could look like, you know, as we think back on mothers, grandmothers, maternal roles within the Mennonite communities. Yeah, so we opened it up for, you know, it was a call for papers, and we had such an interesting array of responses, from different parts of the world, and thinking about maternal roles in a whole variety of ways.
Yeah, that's another amazing archive then that you're building, but also, I guess, I haven't read the book, but were you gathering people's thoughts and essays on the subject, or on how the subject could be explored further, or a bit of both?
A bit of both, and it was also a variety of kinds of writing. You know, there were historical essays, you know, more research based. There were literary essays, and then there were personal narratives. You know, as well as thinking about the ways that cultural expectations around maternity had defined people's lives in different ways within religious contexts, whether or not they were mothers, you know, which is interestingly tied then to my most recent book about inappropriate bodies, because we had people in the Mothering Mennonite book who were not mothers, who were writing about, you know, their personal experiences, whether that was facing infertility or being single or, you know, what have you. But yeah, I think it was sort of the first time that I was thinking more specifically about cultural expectations related to maternity and how that's not just about mothers, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's really exciting because it, as well as the Inappropriate Bodies book, that all of the books that I have seen of yours are definitely like this amazing archival resource. And in true feminist style, you know, the way you're doing that is challenging the norm of how information is gathered, because you have to in order to ensure that you're getting many more. I'm not going to say all, because I know you appreciate in your own books that there are still many more stories to be gathered from different groups of people, but many more than you would get if you followed a traditional academic route, for example, like by including personal letters and personal anecdotes as well. You know, it's the way that we hear about women's lives.
Yes, stories. Exactly. So,
yeah, amazing. So which book or essay within your books, Rachel, has surprised you the most?
I find that it's such a hard question in a sense. Yeah, I've thought a lot about it since you sent the questions earlier, and I don't know that.
Yeah, I thought it was infinite. <to send that. laughs>
I don't know. In a sense, I might say the Have Milk Will Travel book, because that was personal stories about adventures in breastfeeding, which very much came from my own experience. And it's not, you know, it's not an art book and it's not an art historical book. It's all about personal narrative. And yeah, I think in that it was just really striking for me to see the, you know, I knew there was diversity in breastfeeding experiences. You know, that was part of the reason for writing the book, but just to see the sheer diversity, the good, the bad, the ugly, you know, and not just the diversity, but also the really profound ways in which those experiences tended to define the mothers or sort of threaten to define them in a way. Because if things didn't go well, it was soul crushing for women who wrote about it, you know, and to be able to sort of come to terms with whatever is happening with your body and to realize that we can't always control the things that are happening or most often we can't control the things that are happening in our bodies. So I guess I would say that was maybe not surprising, but really striking, I think, for me, in working on that book.
Amazing. That's another one I definitely want to read. I read, I'm not going to remember the name of it now, which will really annoy me and doesn't work. Podcast. I'll edit that out. I read a book by an Australian author, and I want to say it's called Spilled Milk or something, but it's not. I can't remember it. But it was all about looking at breastfeeding in taboos around breastfeeding, basically, and looking at breastfeeding and sexuality and sex and lactation in different forms and other people breastfeeding your babies or you breastfeeding other people's babies. And it was just quite a magical journey of really considering bodies in a different, you know, in a non-Western heteronormative way. and it was amazing. Yeah. So I can see why that would be a really good book of your list. In terms of your own experiences. I would like to talk about your most recent book, Inappropriate Bodies, which does really lead on well from that. The book covers a broad range of essays and conversations about the female body, about the maternal and about maternity. And as you say, not just about mothers, but about maternity, cultural expectations, about design of environments, about family lives and expectations, about bodies, and about art that's associated with this or has come out of this sticky area, and also about challenging social norms through feminist and queer mothering, is such an important concept to be exploring, and so true that women's bodies, whether the women have children or not, are simply considered inappropriate and something that should be controlled. As I said in my question that I sent to you, you know, I've looked at work before around women's bodies and gone back to the time of Hippocrates and his theory of the wandering womb, which is where the term hysteria came from. And, you know, the idea of women's bodies being inappropriate and not behaving properly from then until today is just so relevant, unless, of course, they're fitting specific patriarchally defined roles and environments. So how for you important is it that these conversations are had and you've been able to pull this work together in the book?
Yeah, I think it's such a, I mean, as you can see from the range of books I worked on, I think it's such an increasingly expanding conversation. And that was one of the things that was really important to me with this book was to continue broadening the discussions, you know, that it's not just about one kind of woman or one kind of mother, but there's such diversity to maternal experiences, as well as to maternal expectations, depending on the cultures in which you're living. And thinking, you know, not just about the mothers, but the ways that those expectations are or can be imposed from a very young age on girls, when they may not even realize it, you know.
Yeah.
But you sort of grow up with this expectation of what your life may look like in the place you're living. And then if your life does not fit in that way, or you don't fit into the certain specific like timeline or trajectory, that there's something wrong with you. So hearing artists talk about that really honestly and to see the kinds of work that's being made related to that felt really powerful. And also to start thinking about the systems. That was a piece that my co-editor, Charles Reeve, really brought to it, was that he was very interested in the design element, you know, in part, you know, thinking sort of small scale to large scale, you know, it could be object design, but he was mostly interested, I think, in thinking about institutional systems. And, for example, there's an essay in the book, about the design of hospital birth environments. And yeah.
Oh, that stuck out for me immediately. Doreen, Balabanoff. That's the area that I've read the most of so far.
Yeah. And so she has this sort of very speculative, imaginative, imaging of, you know, what could a hospital birth environment look like in a way that might be more holistic and more helpful for the birthing mother versus the designs that we have today.
Yeah. I've been so I was a doula for a couple of years after I had my two children, and when I was doing that role, and because of my own experiences, I was involved in the local maternity voices group that we had, so that was where the maternity ward invited people from the community to come in and, you know, talk about relevant experiences so that they could get genuine feedback and try and improve the service. And there was a lot of talk about design. They were having a rejig of things, and it was just incredibly frustrating, actually, not just for me, for midwives as well, because of the hospital protocols. And it was those, I think, as well as the physical architecture that was often problematic, like people designing beautiful windows that you couldn't fit blinds on. The rooms were bright lights all the time, and the women wanted to be in a dark, quiet space. You know, things that I just hadn't been thought of. But also, yeah, the rules and the protocols that the midwives and the doctors had to follow, which just gave no autonomy to the women. And the language that was spoken had, you know, unless the women were aware that it was their body and their choice, then they just followed what they were told, because that's the language that's used, you know, that you're expected to follow the professionals. And they are in charge of you and your body and your baby, and you just defer to them. That is the expectation. And so, yeah, that's why that chapter, I think, really stuck out for me. So it's actually such a huge, huge area that there's a lot of scope for, isn't there, in terms of feminist artists being involved with how to how to rethink
that. Yeah, I think,
that.
I mean, of the different sections in the book, I feel like that's the one that has, like, that we're just beginning to look at, you know, that has the most maybe potential for really exploding in future conversations to think, you know, I think in many parts of the world right now, we're, you know, on lots of issues, we're thinking suddenly much bigger picture, you know, not just, it's not just about my individual experience, but it's about this whole system that's in place that we haven't even looked at.
Yeah. These systems that don't account for.
Yeah, exactly.
Many of the population, whether that's because of gender or race or, okay. So your book includes excerpts from authors and artists from across the globe. What similarities and differences did you notice in the experience, the wide range and experiences of the people that you included?
You know, I think sometimes there's a tendency to want to think there's this universality to motherhood, that that there's something that we all share in common, and maybe there is on a very sort of ethereal level. I guess I would say, you know, what we have, the similarity comes in the sort of in the transformation of the role, maybe of motherhood or the caregiving element, you know, whether you're caring for children, caring for parents, thinking more maybe about the maternal than about the mother specifically. But yeah, the differences, I guess, are what really stand out more clearly, because so many of the authors in the book are writing about very specific contexts. You know, Irene Perez is living in Spain and writes really eloquently about the patriarchal masculinist expectations around gender that she faced growing up and the ways in which she is trying to change that narrative for her own daughter. And so the her piece is written as a letter to her daughter, sharing a lot about her own childhood experiences and experiences as a young adult. Related to gender expectations and standards of beauty and where motherhood fits into that. And somebody like Shira Richter, thinking about, you know, the context in which she lives, which is in Israel, and in a much more, or you might say much more of a political hotspot, and what are the, where does the mother fit into that in a more kind of nationalistic sense? So I think a real diversity of locations, which inform a lot about, you know, what the maternal expectations are sort of from place to place.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the important aspects that I've got from your work as well, and I think I am quoting you when you talk about the importance of not reinventing the wheel. And that why it's really important to have these conversations, but to have these archives and this work that shows it, and to share and connect and continue to share, so that we don't just have these pockets of work that isn't seen, that isn't talked about. Now that is something that I've heard within the fields of feminism and maternity repeatedly, and I'm sure I will continue to. Because now I don't know as much about in terms of feminism, because I think maybe I don't know enough feminists that have dropped out of banging the drum, maybe. but I know definitely within maternity, it feels like it can be a period in your life that you have the focus or the momentum and the energy to look at that area. And then many people kind of step away from that again, maybe when their children are grown, or being maternal is not affecting their lives in the same way as it did when they were trying for children, or being considered wrong for not having children because of their age, or, you know, I guess that maybe changes, and it's not always, doesn't maybe always feel relevant. But what do you think? So I'll get to my point. What do you think the best way of achieving this is? So not reinventing the wheel. How do you think we can go about
that? I do think it's important to have this sort of, you know, body of work, of labor, of activism that tries to make change over a period of time, so that women and mothers don't always have to reinvent the wheel. You know, at the same time, I do totally understand the importance of when somebody enters a really powerful stage of life and feels like they have something to say, you know, that it comes from a very personal place, you know, for an artist or a writer, that maybe feels very important, and not that you're disregarding everything that's come before, but you want to contribute to the conversation. So I really get that impulse as well. But I guess I would say it's more about continuing to make connections with people, and to realize that, so you've had this really powerful experience, but you can't assume that your experience is the normative maternal experience. And what might you learn for your, you know, that could inform you in new ways, or broaden your understandings, or help you by hearing from somebody else's experiences, whether that's in the present or looking to the past, to an archive. And I know probably feminists from the 1970s, from the second wave movement, you know, struggled with feeling like feminists who came later weren't paying attention to the work that they had already done. Why are you, you know, sort of, again, trying to reinvent the wheel? Well, you know, we've done this already. You know, so there maybe is sort of an inevitable cycle to some of this history, but I think, like you, maternity, yeah, it is, it's,
yeah,
I think for some people, it can be this very sort of flash in the pan, like it's powerful. And then suddenly, like in the early childhood years feel like they last forever sometimes, but then suddenly you're in a different stage, and maybe things don't feel quite as urgent. So that's, yeah, there are some differences certainly from the kinds of feminist activism that people might sustain over a much longer period of time.
Yeah. And I think as well, there probably is some relevance to the wheel being reinvented.
Yeah, repositioned for sure. Yeah.
Repositioned because actually sometimes there hasn't been enough change, or the issues are still the same. And so it's okay to continue to talk about those same issues. And think about them,
yeah,
you know, from the current generation. I've just been thinking while we've been talking about so one woman who is an author and campaigner in the UK called Hibo Wader, and she is a mother who experienced FGM as a child. In Somalia, I'm hoping I might be wrong about where she was from, and she speaks very powerfully around the world now about anti-FGM campaigning, and she has some, you know, quite powerful experiences, but also some really great thoughts on where things can go in terms of women and the maternal, and expectations for women who face FGM, and also for women who are pressurized within their communities about making FGM happen to their own children. So I think she might be a really interesting person for you to connect with. And also Women Picturing Revolution, who are a New York-based organization. The two women who run that are Leslie Deschler-Canossi and Zoraida Lopez-Diego. And they're currently working on a book which is focusing on Black, I don't know if I can find it, but it's it's representation of Black motherhood and photography. That's what it's called. So again, yeah, they've got some amazing work, and they're gathering some fantastic experiences again, and representations of Black motherhood.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, thank you.
Another area that might be a great connection for you. So my final question for you, Rachel, is what's next? What have you got in the pipeline?
So everything has slowed down. I think in many places, in a sense, as you know, the things sort of shut down to the pandemic. But that has been, good for me to think about, because, something that's been oh, sort of in the back of my mind, or maybe the front of my mind, the last couple of years has to do with slowness. I think a lot of it for me comes out of the work with the maternal, thinking about what could be maternal conceptions of time. What is the time needed to care? You know, it's not a fast time; it's a slow, durational time, sort of unfolding. And I've thought a lot about the ways that traditions of making are passed between generations, and these kinds of slow practices, whether that's letter writing between generations or different traditions of handwork, needlework, embroidery, et cetera, these things that take a long time to do. So I've been thinking sort of generally about slow practices. And I think this kind of pandemic time is giving me a little bit of a new lens through which to look at that as well. So it's sort of early stages thinking, but I think it's something I'll be looking more at, you know, in through writing and through making as well, some artistic projects related to slowness. And I guess maybe related to that. So one thing I started doing when things shut down here was to start writing letters. I started a daily practice, which I've never had before, but of writing one letter every day to someone somewhere, as a way of, you know, first it was sort of as a way of maintaining connection, when things felt very disorienting. And now it's just become part of a daily routine, I guess, a daily conversation with somebody, which feels really good. And, you know, some of them turn into back and forth correspondences and others are just sort of sent out and that's okay.
So is it often to different people then? It's not
right. So it's to many different people. Some from long ago and some friends from recent years and, a whole variety, but they're all handwritten. Nice. And they're on paper that I've marbled by hand. And so there's a lot of time invested in that feels really good to me right now. Which again, I think relates to the idea of care as well.
It does take a lot of care to sit and write a letter. That's really poignant. And I love I've heard lots of people talking about wanting to, if they want to take anything out of this time for those that have slowed. I mean, there are lots of people who have not. but for those who have and who have been forced to slow, I think there's been a real appreciation for some people in terms of taking that forward outside of this situation.
You bring up a good point, because I think that's also helped me think about slowness in a different way, in terms of, you know, who has the privilege to be slow. How might we think about enacting forms of slowness that could be accessible to everybody, you know, when we were in these societies where it's often very class related, who can be slow and who cannot.
And geographically, I guess, as well, because the whole period for me has been very similar to my own experience of maternity leave. I'm in the UK here. We meant not everybody, because if you're freelance, doesn't work. But if you are employed, you get 6 to 9 months, of low paid, but still paid maternity, which I loved and struggled with because of the change of pace and the change of role and, you know, all of that that I'm sure you've heard discussed many times before. But I think this period has been quite similar. You know, the people who, it's probably going to be similar people who have that same privilege of being slow, you know, may have the same privileges of having maternity leave. And so those who it hasn't affected in the same way, maybe, maternity will undoubtedly affect them in different ways.
And as a teacher too, I've been thinking about, that it's not just about a slowing down, but how can I bring slowness into the classroom, or think about slowness differently, you know, that it's maybe about focusing more intently, for example, in teaching an art history survey, you know, maybe there are a lot of things that end up being left out and you focus more intently and specifically on fewer things to help students think more critically and look more critically at work and understand things in a different way than if you're trying to cram in, you know, all of the paintings and sculptures that you think are super important for them to know about. So trying to, you know, and especially in a time of remote learning when it can be such a struggle anyway for students to even hang on, you know, how can slowness maybe be a help to them as well?
I think that's really important and probably a really good place for us to finish, Rachel.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. It's been great talking with you.
Oh, thank you so much as well.
You've been listening to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. For more of our episodes, visit the Desperate Artwives website or find us on Apple iTunes.